goodness. Well, some more news to bring you on that attack, because the Tunisian health minister has been speaking on radio in the country, and he says that the number of people killed in that attack has risen to 37, with 36 wounded. So a jump from the number 28 we were reporting a little earlier. 37 now reported dead in that attack in the hotel in Sousse. 36 people wounded. Now, let's talk to Hannah Stuart, who's research fellow at the foreign affairs think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. She joins us from central London. Hannah Jackson, I mean, why Tunisia?
I think one of the reasons that Tunisia has been attacked is because it is arguably the only success story of the Arab Spring. It's one of the most liberal Muslim majority countries in the Middle East and North Africa. And it's and for that reason, I think Islamic State and other jihadist groups want to punish it for its success, for its democracy, for its pluralism. And to make it fearful of those what we would consider its progressive values.
Do they find it easier to operate in a democracy rather than a more authoritarian country?
Yes, I think that's certainly true. I mean, we can see, we just have to contrast Egypt and Tunisia as two post-Arab Spring countries. And Tunisia has grappled for the last two, 3 years, particularly with resurgent terrorist groups. Ansar al-Sharia in Tunisia has grown in stature. There's been weapon smuggling from Libya, from Algeria. There have been multiple counter-terrorism operations within the country. They had two political assassinations in 2013 alone. We had the attacks in March of this year. It's been very difficult for the Tunisian authorities to clamp down on this.
If the attacks in Tunisia, France, Kuwait aren't linked operationally that we've seen today, what does link them?
I think two things link them. Firstly, the inspiration, the motivation. You know, if you think of Shia worshippers, holiday makers in Tunisia, and a factory worker in France, what unites them? Well, for jihadists like Islamic State or Al-Qaeda, what unites them is that they are outside of what is considered to them the acceptable fold of Islam. They're infidels and they're heretics, or they're traitors. And so that's one thing that unites these attacks. But I think the other thing is also the timing, that it is Friday and it's during Ramadan, so it's the Muslim holy month. And where most Muslims believe that the good deeds that they do will be rewarded extra specially, but for jihadists, this really is a call to arms, and that what they do, for them, they are fighting in the path of Allah, and that for them, their God will reward them more so because they're doing these attacks now.
And so, I mean, faced with what's happened today, both in Europe and in North Africa and in the Gulf, what are security services to do? They're already on a high state of alert. How do they manage this?
I think it's especially difficult for security services. And when we think about the Tunisian attack and the France attack in particular, we see the differences between, in Tunisia, the suspect was not on the security services radar, whereas in France he was. And questions are asked about, is there more that they can do? But in France, the suspect was on the watch list, but came off it after 2 years because there was considered to be inactivity. So that's one lesson, perhaps, that even when people drop off a certain level on the radar, they should stay on that. Of course, as I said, what links these are the inspiration from Islamic State. So more, perhaps, has to be done to tackle that, to tackle the issue at its root, really, the radicalization of youth across the world. They're what's attracting them to actually act on behalf of Islamic State against their fellow citizens.
Hannah Stuart, thank you very much for joining us there from the Henry Jackson Society. She was in central London. Thank you.